been thinking about this series for a long time, and what would it mean? What would change in our lives? What would change in our church if we gave people the ability to tell their story? And so over the next few weeks leading up to Easter, we're going to find out how our story is connected to God's story and how our story is connected to the resurrection story. And you're going to hear from real life people of what their lives were like before Christ, what their lives are like now in Christ, and the things that they have battled, struggled with, and how God is good in the middle of difficulty. I think one of the things that gets lost in our story is what we see in our culture, is that in our culture, isn't it amazing that there are so many numbers attached to our name, right? Think about it. As you walked in here today, there's probably numbers attached to your name. There is a PIN number that's attached to your name, a social security number that's attached to your name, an employee ID number that's attached to your name. If you're a student, definitely a student ID number that's attached to your name. Think of all the important things in your life that are part of your life, your story, that have numbers attached to it. There's an area code, which is a number. There's a zip code, which is a number. There is your address, which has a... So you're with me so far. Report cards, GPAs, all of those have these connections of numbers. In fact, your passwords have numbers. In fact, here's a little admission today. How many people would say that they change your passwords on a regular basis because they forget them? Come on, how many people... Come on, let's be honest. It is much easier to hit that little tab at the bottom that says reset password instead of thinking through what? The letters and the caps and the special characters and the numbers. And so we just touch that little thing at the bottom, reset. How many people reset our passwords each and every week? I will not say who does that in our house, but there's several people in our house that do that on a regular basis. Numbers. You walk into a store. Unless it's like a mom and pop shop where you do business on a regular basis, they don't call you by your name. They call you by a what? You go to Walmart today, you're going to go to Publix today, and you want to get something at the deli. You're going to get some cheese. You're going to get some bologna. You're going to get some, I don't know what you're going to get back there, but you step up to the counter, and they don't call you Billy Bob. They don't call you Steve. They don't call you Susie. You step up there, there's a really busy line, and you grab a ticket, and on that ticket there is a... Number 42, number 42, number 42. And when you get it, it's like you won the lottery. You know, you get to order your cheese. You get your bologna. You go to the DMV. As much as we hate the DMV, let me just say that for those of you that are, you know, from somewhere else. The DMV in Florida has run really good compared to a whole lot of other places that I've been to. Florida's is much better than what I've experienced in Boston and in Indiana. You walk in there. And you're given a number and a letter, right? And based upon what you've got to do, you're watching the monitor and you're hearing the voices. And I've done this a couple of times over the past few weeks because both of my 15-year-olds have gotten their permits. And so you're watching and you're listening, E-491, E-491. You can step up now to window number 15. And you're watching and you're paying attention, hoping that your number comes. A few weeks ago when we were there, I think they got a little frustrated because E-491 was getting called 14 million times. And this isn't the first time I've seen it that an actual individual got out there. Hey, who is number E-491? E-491 at window number 15 right now. It's easy, I think, in our story and in our culture and with our names, because there's so many numbers attached to our name that sometimes lose our identity. I mean, isn't this what happens when we look at other people? Isn't it what happens when we look at ourselves? You know, we live in a corporate culture. I thank God for capitalism because it gives us the ability to be whoever we want to be. You can dream the biggest dreams. You can be an entrepreneur. You can be a successful athlete. You can be whatever you want to be in this country. It's what a lot of other countries don't have. But if we're not careful, we get caught up in the capitalistic idea of that. And people become bottom lines. And people become statistics. And people become another sales. And they don't have names. And they don't have stories. They're simply statistics. I think we even learn that when we go to high school and college. Because when you're in high school and college, and this is the way that it works, a lot of times we're defined by numbers. You play for a football team, and on the back of your jersey is what? A number. And if you have a great game, then you feel good about yourself. If you have a bad game, you feel bad about yourself. It's a number. And you go to school throughout your entire life, and you're told that your life amounts to your SAT scores, your ACT scores, and your GPA. And if your GPA is great, then it gets you to certain places. If your GPA is not great, you don't have as many opportunities. This is what qualifies for your scholarship and what doesn't. And even as a student, we get wrapped up in numbers, and we see ourselves rather than a name or a story, we see ourselves as a statistic and a number. We're going to spend a few weeks leading up to the resurrection story, which is the ultimate story of Jesus' resurrection. And we're going to see what it means to have a name rather than a number, to have a story rather than a statistic. In fact, as we go through these next few weeks, there's really a key idea that I put into this particular series, and it simply is this, is that every person has a name, and every name has a story. Every person has a name, and every name has a story. And we might say, duh, I get that. But somewhere in the middle of this, we lose our identity, we lose our name, we lose our stories in the melee of life. And I want to say this, just to set it as a foundation, we believe that your name and your story is ultimately defined and finds purpose in a personal relationship with God through Jesus Christ. Everything else is just window dressings. So I'm going to ask a few questions today, and simply as we establish this foundation for the next few weeks, here's the question: what is significant about my story? What is significant about my name? What is significant about my purpose and my destiny in life? If I have a story, what is significant about Steve? What is significant about Warren? What is significant about Sue? What is significant about us? I'm just going to give you three things today. Number one is simply this, is that God personally knows me and knows my name. And I recognize the fact that we reach people that don't believe in God, that may have an agnostic view of God, people that are seeking God, people that are fully devoted followers of Jesus. And I want you to understand that if you're going to discover your true purpose and your story and your name, that somewhere along the line, you've got to have a conversation. You've got to figure out, where does God fit into that? We say that often here, that what you do with Jesus is your turning point. Whether you accept him or reject him, that impacts every aspect, every decision, every relationship, every dollar that you spend, and it's part of your definition of your story. Psalm 139 is a great foundational scripture. If you've never read it before, go home and read it. I'm reading from a Message paraphrase today just to kind of give us a fresh set of views on this. But listen to what it says. It says, God, I'm an open book to you. Even from a distance, you know what I'm thinking. Now that is both scary and refreshing, isn't it? Whatever thought you had on the way to church, whatever fight you had on the way to church, whatever you're thinking about doing after church, God knows that right now. So keep it, I know you're thinking about your brackets. Let's focus on my story right now, okay? God, I'm an open book to you. Even from a distance, you know what I'm thinking. You know when I leave and when I get back, I'm never out of your sight. You know everything I'm going to say before I start the first sentence. I look behind me and you're there. And then up ahead and you're there. Two, your reassuring presence is coming and going. God knows our thoughts. God knows our comings. God knows our goings. God knows what we're going to say. You think you're good as a parent anticipating what your children are going to say? God is even better. Verse 7. Is there any place I can go to avoid your spirit, to be out of your sight? If I climb to the sky, you're there. If I go underground, you're there. If I flew on the morning's wings to the farthest horizons, if I jumped on a plane and I flew to the Bahamas right now, you're there. You find me in a minute. You're already there waiting. Then I said to myself, oh, he sees me even in the dark. This is an amazing thing. You get on the fastest plane, and you go to the furthest place in the world, and God is there. You go up, and you're near the moon, and God is there. You try to get to the depths of the ocean, and God is there. And here's the part that I like. Even when we try to hide in the dark, and we try to play hide-and-go-seek with God, with the darkest recesses of our hearts and our minds, that brokenness that lives inside of us, God sees it. Isn't that amazing? Continues on. Oh, yes, you shape me. From my inside out, you form me in my mother's womb. Body and soul, I am marvelously made. You know me inside and out. You know every bone in my body. You know exactly how I was made, bit by bit, how I was sculpted from nothing into something. I'm like an open book. You watched me grow from conception to birth. All the stages of my life were spread out before you. The days of my life all prepared before even I lived one day. And the God values life, no matter what form it's in, whether it's in the womb, all the way up to the tomb. God sees that we have value. Before your mom and dad ever dreamed you up, before your ever name was ever attached to you, God said, I had a purpose, I had a plan, I had pages, I had chapters, I had a book that was your life. Wrap your mind around that. Then you and I are more than a number, we're a name. We're more than a statistic, we're a story. If I were to boil Psalm 139 down into one phrase, it's simply this, is that it all starts with God. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 words, it all starts with God. And your story finds purpose in God. Your future finds purpose in God. And again, that's your decision. God never forces himself on us. But if we're going to be more than a statistic in this life, if our story is going to mean something, that it all starts with God. So let me just say two things. Number one, If you're investigating faith, if you're newer to faith, can I say this so you understand, no matter what culture has told you, no matter what the people in your life has told you, you're not a mistake. You're not an afterthought. You're not a problem. You're not a statistic in God's eyes. God sees you as potential. God sees you with purpose. God sees you as men and women and students, as the best chapters of your life can still be written with Him. And you're not an accident in God's eyes. And God has got something special that He still wants to do in and through your life. But it means a realization that it starts with God. Number two, maybe you're a Jesus follower. And maybe you've read this passage before and you've heard other preachers speak from Psalm 139, and maybe your devotion was there recently, but there's a part of you that just feels devalued right now, and you feel like life has just been kicking your butt, and you don't feel value, you don't feel important, you feel like your story is broken and twisted. And maybe the question in your mind right now is like, God, why are these things happening in my story? And I just want to be an encouragement to you. Is that the scripture says this, is that in all things, God works for what? The good. That God uses the nasty, the messy, the dirty, the awful, the broken, the betrayals, that God uses all of those things to produce some good out of your story. And I still believe that even as a Jesus follower, the best days of your story still lie ahead. Some phrases I put in your notes today. And again, I hope you will not just listen to me, but I hope you'll turn over the connection card, take some notes. I hope you'll open up your app and grow from this. But here's a couple of statements. God has given you a great name. God has given you a great story. Let's personalize it a little bit. Let's take out the you and let's put in the word me. And maybe would you read those with me? Let's say it out loud. God has given me a great name. God has given me a great story. That was not very enthusiastic, okay? Help me out here today, all right? You can talk back in church, all right? God has given me a great name. God has given me a great story. And that's not just positive, mumbo-jumbo faith talk. It all starts with God. And I become more of a statistic, and I become a story when I understand that He is the foundation for it. Behind your name and behind your story is a great God. But here's the challenge, number two. What is significant about my name? What is significant about my story? My name and my story have been marred. And again, maybe you've heard this before. Maybe you've heard this from me before. Maybe you're a Jesus follower and you understand this. But I feel that in order for us to tell the stories of people over these next few weeks, and you hear stories that deal with addiction, and you hear stories that deal with insecurities and an abuse, and you hear stories that deal with a loss, somewhere along the line is that we all have these marred aspects of our lives. We all have these broken pieces of our lives. And this is a game changer, because if we think we are all that, if we think that our story is perfect, then we are missing part of the story that God wants to create in us. My name and my story have been marred. Listen to the words of Jesus in the book of John, chapter 3 and verse 19. It simply says this. It says, this is the verdict. Light has come into the world. These are the words of Jesus. This is after John 3:16. For God so loves the world, for God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but through Him man might be saved, that we might have a relationship. And then Jesus unpacks a few things and He says, light is coming to the world. He says, hey, the world is dark and the world is broken, and I am light. I've come to illuminate. I've come to expose. I've come to create stories that are amazing. And this is what He says. The light has come to the world, but people loved what? People love darkness. Jesus says people. Not only was it that New Testament people, but He was saying in 21st century people, Southwest Florida, people sitting in a church in Bonita Springs in the middle of March of 2019. Hey, those people love darkness. And if we're really honest, there's elements of our lives where we actually gravitate towards darkness. Scripture calls it sin. A very un-PC word today, a very uncomfortable word, but a true word, that it exists in all of us and it mars our story. And then Jesus has the gall to say this. He says, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were what? Come on, Jesus, when I think of my life, I don't think of evil. Dark, I'll give that to you, Jesus. There's some dark thoughts that I have. There's some dark things that I've said. There's some things that I would be ashamed of if people knew the darkness of the recesses of my heart. But evil? That word is reserved for people like Hitler, like for Jeffrey Dahmer. I'm not evil. And yet Jesus uses the word of light and of darkness and of evil all in the same sentence. You know, when I read this passage, it made me think of a few things. It made me think of one of the frustrations I have as a parent. You know, any parent ever sit down and try to figure out how to watch a movie with your kids and something inappropriate comes up on the screen? Does that happen to anybody? Does anybody else agree that G, PG, PG-13, and R mean absolutely nothing when you're watching a movie today? It seems like that. Thank goodness, you know, there's filtering systems that are getting better at it, and there's websites where you can go and read at it, so you don't have like one of these shock and awe moments where you're with your kids. But it frustrates me, because we'll be sitting down, and we'll have family night, and family night for us is on Friday nights, and we'll have a meal, or we'll have popcorn, and we'll pick something on Netflix, or we'll pick something on Hulu, or we'll try to filter something, and we'll watch it, and it might say PG-13, and it's great, and it's action, and all of a sudden the lead character goes, bleepity, bleepity, bleep, 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 bleep. It's like, oh, wow, I didn't read that in the rankings there. I didn't know that you could say that many of those kinds of words. And the kids look at each other and they look at me, and my wife usually gives me the stink eye because I wasn't on the remote fast enough. It's true. And it's not necessary, but it taints the story, right? It's a great action-packed movie. There's all kinds of things happening. And that guy didn't have to drop that bomb. That guy didn't have to say that thing. And you're watching a little bit more, and the action's going, and it goes bleepity bleepity bleep bleep bleep. And it's like, come on, wait, well, this was PG-13, right? And if you're a parent, you're watching that, and it's an embarrassing moment, at least it is for me, it mars the moment. It mars the what's happening in that moment as a family. We've watched PG movies before. Great Disney PG movies, and all of a sudden one character to another character has a sexual innuendo, and I look at my wife, and she looks at me, and I look at my kids, and they snicker at me, and I'm thinking, why did they have to put that in the movie? Now I've got to explain that to them and what that means. It's amazing how a family night can be marred because of one F word. Not for me, from the movie, okay? Just so we're clear on that, all right? That came out and that didn't sound right, all right? And how the family night can be marred simply because of that sexual innuendo. It reminded me, as I was reading this passage and thinking through this, about 25 years ago when churches were trying to reach out to the community, they used the Super Bowl as leverage to kind of connect with, because everybody loves football. And there were there was great Super Bowls, you know, and I'm dating myself, back in the 90s and the early 2000s. And all I remember is this one year we had 200 or 300 people spread out in our auditorium, or it was in our gymnasium, and chili cook-off and kids and teenagers, and it was a great football game. And up until this point, most commercials were family-friendly, and most halftime shows were family-friendly. Well, we didn't do enough research to realize that this year, during the halftime show, Victoria's Secret was going to have its own special halftime show. Apparently, when you wear lingerie and you put on angel wings, it's okay. You guys remember that back? Remember that? It's a long time ago. Don't go Google it. Don't go Google it. You'll get yourself in trouble, okay? So we're watching the football game, and all of a sudden the halftime show comes up, and all of a sudden all of these scantily clad ladies in their lingerie and their angel wings start marching across, and I won't do it for you, okay, all right? They start marching across in front of the screens, and you would see three grown men that were leading that. You know, we were running towards the projector. It was like it was in slow motion. We couldn't get there fast enough. You got kids seeing this. You got teenagers looking at this, you know. All of this is happening in a church environment. We get up there, one of the guys grabs the cap to the actual projector and he drops it on the floor. No! You're with me. Family-friendly football angels. Family football gridiron angels. Oh. It was a great football game. But the entire night, if you want to say, and we laugh now, right? I can promise you on Monday morning, we were not laughing at staff meeting, okay? We were stressed. We were freaking out because the whole halftime show marred, if you want to say, the entire football game. What's my point? Is I have a story, and I have a name, you have a story, and you have a name, but too often our stories and our names have been tainted by all kinds of darkness in our lives. And I use commercials, and I use sexual innuendo, and I use the guy as a movie. And no matter what your life is rated or ranked, if you want to say, there are things that we allow, whether they're infomercials or commercials. There's moments in our lives where we say things that taint our lives. There's things that we do relationally that taint our lives. There's this honesty that we do that taint our lives. There's things that we think and we process and we want to do that put a darkness, if you want to say, and mar the story of our lives. Just like sitting in a living room and watching a TV show with my children, it just puts a bad taste in our mouths. And every one of us have those marred elements of darkness that Jesus calls out. And here's what I know. Nobody is ever proud of them. You know, every now and then we get this idea on TV, or maybe if you're hanging out with your guys, or maybe you see something on social media where someone is bragging about their drunken stupor or cheating on such and such or being able to be dishonest with somebody. But normally people in their honest moments of life do not brag about those dark moments. They're ashamed by them, aren't they? Have you ever heard a person say, man, I was so angry today. I eviscerated my boss. I eviscerated my wife. I eviscerated my kids. Yeah, I did such a good job. I've never heard that. Man, when it came to lust today, I was so good. I mean, I was on the internet and I was on the TV and my lust was off the chain. And I want to say, man, I would give myself an A+. No one ever says that. Nobody. If we're honest, it's those moments that stain our stories, that mar our stories, that ruin the overall action and the drama and the romance that take place in our lives. And they sit there on the pages of our lives and they stain them. Would you agree with that? And we're not proud of them. And this is what Jesus is saying. And then Jesus doesn't let up. Verse 20, he says, everyone who does evil, everyone who is in darkness, hates the light. Oh, come on, Jesus, man, you're throwing out all kinds of trash talk now. Darkness and evil. Jesus, I don't hate God, and I don't hate the light. And maybe that's true. I don't hate God. I don't hate what is right, but I think what Jesus is trying to communicate to us, because God is so holy and because we're so dark, when we gravitate towards darkness, it is like hatred, if you want to say, compared to God's holiness. And then Jesus continues. Verse 20, it says, they will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. They will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. We all have deeds that can be exposed, right? We all have things in our story that we're not proud of. There's something in chapter 68, page 13, that we wish we wouldn't have done. There's something on page 122 in chapter 482 that we wish we wouldn't have said. We all have those. And what Jesus is saying is one of the reasons why we don't step into the light and allow him to redeem our stories is what? It's right in the middle. What is that word? Fear. And maybe that fear is because of something we believe about God. Maybe this fear of being rejected by somebody. Maybe it's fear that if someone really knew the darkness in my life, that they would reject me and not accept me. In the Hunger Games, there is this classic scene where everyone is lined up. And if you don't know the understanding of the Hunger Games, here's the paraphrased version. Every district must submit two people, two tributes, every few years that are going to battle in this thing called what? The Hunger Games. And it is a death match. And this has got, you know, young men and young women, little girls, little boys. And each of these districts must submit two people. The issue is that when they call people out, nobody wants to be called into that death match. Everybody is fearful. Nobody wants to be exposed. And here is what that looks like. And I believe connects with us today. Take a look.
Now, the time has come for us to select one courageous young man and woman for the honor of representing District 12 in the 74th annual Hunger Games. As usual, ladies first. Where are you? Come on, Anna. Well, come on up.
Tribute. I believe we have a volunteer.
Mr. Mayor?
I need to get out of here. You need to get out of here.
No.
Go find Mom.
No.
Grim, go find Mom right now.
No.
So sorry.
No.
Find Mom.
No.
Grim, leave. Go find Mom.
No. No.
It's an awful clip, isn't it? You can see, even if you've never seen the movie, you can see the fear in the people's faces, hoping that their name will not be called, hoping they will not have to compete in the games, because the majority of the games is death. And they know that if they're in the games, if they're exposed in the games, that their enemies are going to expose their weaknesses and probably kill them. And what does that got to do with you and me? I think one of the reasons why Jesus' words are so convicting about our stories, why we gravitate towards darkness, is because we're afraid. There is a fear inside of us. And I mentioned a few of those just a minute ago, that maybe we have this perception that if I admit, and here's the irony, that if I admit that I'm broken before God, that somehow God will reject me. And that's an untruth. That maybe somehow if I admit who I am and my brokenness, that there is no one else like me. And that's an untruth, because there's a whole lot of other people just like you. And maybe that if I admit my darkness in front of a group of Jesus followers, that maybe somehow they will kick me to the curb and throw me under the bus. Fear. I think this is a place actually where we can, as Jesus followers, as a church, as we amp up for Easter and prepare for what God is going to do in this place, and literally as hundreds and hundreds of people will be here over the next 4 weeks, that Jesus followers, that maybe one of the greatest reasons why people don't walk into a church, don't walk into a relationship with God, is because of what? Fear. Because there's pockets of Jesus followers, unfortunately. There's pockets of churches, unfortunately. And I think this is a lesson that we can learn of, that when people walk into a right relationship with God and people walk into our churches and they admit who they are, that somehow we see ourselves as better than, superior than, more spiritually mature than. And that breaks my heart. That breaks the heart of God when somehow, in some way, that we see ourselves as Jesus followers as better than other people. And there are pockets within Christianity that almost see ourselves that it is a spiritual badge of maturity, that if my life is together, that if I am holy, that if I never struggle and I never sin, that I see myself as better than other people. And it's it's not maturity. You know what it is? It's arrogance. And it's pride. And it keeps people from knowing Jesus. I am so proud of this church, that this is a place and this is a group of people where we don't judge people when they come in, but we accept people for who they are. And we allow Jesus to change them. We don't change them. We allow Jesus to change minds. We allow Jesus to change hearts. That is the mission of the church. That is who we are to be, to meet people where they are in their fear. Jesus continues in this particular passage. Not only is my story significant because of, begins with God, and not only is my story significant because of me being marred, but my story is significant because I can be redeemed. See, that's the hope of everything that we're talking about today. That's where fear is met today. That is where every one of our stories gets improved. Is there a possibility for you and I to actually have my name and my story redeemed? And I go, and I know, and I get this. Many of us are Jesus followers, and we've seen this before, and we've heard this before, but we need to understand that our mission as a church, my mission as a Jesus follower, is to let people know that they are more than a statistic, that they are more than a number, that in Jesus Christ, their story and their best chapters lay ahead of them. That's why I said for number three is that my story and my name can actually be redeemed. And this is what Jesus says. Look at what he says in John chapter 3, verses 21. And this is the contrast. After all of the harsh words from Jesus, after the words of darkness and hatred and evil, Jesus actually then gives us hope. He says, but whoever lives by the truth comes into the what? Light. A little bit more emphatic, but whoever lives in the darkness comes into the
light.
Yeah. That there is hope, that there is a possibility, that for every marred chapter of my life, there's the possibility that God can do something in my life. For everything that I've broken, for every PG-13 thing that I have violated, for everything that I've said, that in the story, in the pages of my story, God can redeem my story. And this is the beautiful thing of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that Jesus is light. I wrote this in your notes today, and it simply says this. It says, my name and my story finds redemption when I walk in the light of Christ. My name and my story finds redemption when I walk in a relationship with Christ. My name and my story finds redemption when I recognize that I need Christ. This is going to seem like a really odd question coming out of this verse, but how many people really hate cockroaches? We're going to mix it up today. It's funny that in my family, 5 out of 6 people in my family despise cockroaches. It's funny. We watch my family, you think there was something nasty happening in our house. It's unfortunate, you know. We live here in Florida. Doesn't matter how much you spray your house, doesn't matter how much you clean your house, those little buggers can find their way into any nook and cranny in your house, and they pop up everywhere, right? You guys with me on this? Everybody in my house hates cockroaches. I'll hear someone scream, ah, in the middle of whatever. And I think that something's gone wrong. I feel like maybe the television set fell on somebody. Somebody broke a leg and there's a dead cockroach in the middle of the road or in the middle of the living room. And I'll walk out there every now and then because I know that people in my family hate cockroaches. And I'll look at it. And I'll pick it up. And I will just follow people in my home. Right? They hate cockroaches, and I can make my family literally do anything with a cockroach in my hand. I literally. Now, they wig me out and they freak me out, but that, you know, that's, we all hate cockroaches, all right? I never thought my daughter Ellie could run so fast in her entire life. One day I actually picked up a cockroach that I think she sprayed. You know, for whatever, in my house, you can find whatever spray, and you just spray a cockroach and you assume that it's dead, whether it's hairspray or whether it's deodorant or whatever. I picked one up one day that was still a little bit moving. I didn't even have a paper towel, and I just picked it up by its little leg, all right? And I went right towards Ellie, and I began to walk towards Ellie. And I have never seen my daughter in her life be so motivated. That girl ran out of our kitchen, down our driveway, past the mailbox, to the stop sign before I ever got to the driveway. So to see how fast my daughter would run, I began to run after her, and I couldn't catch up. Just because I had a cockroach and actually dropped it halfway through. Just because I pretended to have a cockroach in my hand. I've got a point with this. I'm going somewhere, okay? I promise. There's a spiritual connotations. Where do cockroaches tend to live? In the dark. My very first missions trip, I found myself in 1993 in what used to be the former Soviet Union, now Russia. And it was still reeling from years and years of communism and socialism and all the things that just really broke Russia. And we were staying in what appeared to be a former five-star hotel. It was not a five-star. It was dark. It was dreary. It was damp. It was nasty. And this is where we would spend our time in Moscow before we would go out into these different college campuses. We were going in. We had a really long flight, and we got in that night, and everybody was starting to tuck into bed, took their showers, getting ready. I noticed people putting earplugs in their ears and putting those flight things on their eyes and getting ready to tuck into bed. And I'm the newbie. I'm 22, 23 years old, never been on a missions trip. I was the ugly American. And I basically said, well, what are you guys doing? Somebody turn off the lights. So, is anybody going to turn off the lights? It's time to go to bed. And they said, go ahead, Steve, and see what happens. I didn't know what they were talking about. So, you know, I'm the arrogant little 22, 23-year-old guy. My first mission trip, I stand over by the light just to make sure they're not going to do anything to me. And I flip the light off, and they're just talking to me with their little iPads on, their little, you know, not the iPads, like Apple. You know what I'm talking about, right? Things in their ears. Just go ahead, Steve, turn it off. But stay right there. And so I just kind of turned it off, and for about a minute or two, I began to hear noises in the room, and I began to hear these weird things in the room. They said, Steve, turn it back on. And I turned it back on, and this is not a joke. Former five-star hotel, downtown Moscow, our room is covered in cockroaches. This is my first missions experience. Anybody want to go on a missions trip with us? Anybody? I flip the light back on, and they begin to scurry. They begin to find, they go back to their dark places. They begin to hide. Again, to go back to where they are. We know that the way to get rid of a cockroach is not to chase your daughter down the street, although that's amusing, is light. Is that darkness hates light. Cockroaches hate light. The way that you and I see our lives and our story redeemed is not by flipping a light on, unless the light is the person of Jesus Christ. And when we walk into a right relationship with God through Jesus Christ and allow the Holy Spirit to flip on the light in our hearts and our souls, to expose the recesses of our hearts, of our minds, of our souls, of every nook and cranny, of everything that we've stained the pages of our lives, that is when you and I begin to have hope. That is when you and I begin to have purpose. That is when you and I can begin to see for the very first time that our stories can be redeemed. But the only way to get rid of those critters in our lives is through the power of Jesus. Jesus says this particularly in Scripture. In John chapter 3, verses 21, it simply says this, and this is the rest of the passage. I'm going to share it with you. He says, but whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what he has been done through God. Listen to me. I'm going to read that again because this is a life-changing moment right here. But whoever lives by truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what he has done has been done through God. Here's what changes our stories. It's not your morality. It's not how good you are. It's not how sexy you are at the gym. It's not how much you can lift at the gym. It's not how much you get paid. It's not how religious you are. It's not how many prayers you do. None of those things are what make our story redeemable. It's nothing that none of those things bring hope into our life. It's what God has done through us. The life change is when we allow God's Spirit to live inside of us, to flip the switch on in our hearts, our minds, and our souls, to expose the darkness and allow God's Holy Spirit to live in us. Are you with me so far? That is where change comes from. If I were to put it in simple terms as this, is that when Christ comes into your life, that he being the light, he exposes and he dispels darkness. That what people need to see and hear, and you hear this throughout the entire New Testament, what people need to see and hear is the life change of your life. They need to see and hear the life change of your story. They need to see it. See, one of the things that I say, whether people are pessimistic with faith, and we reach those kinds of people, and if you're here today, I'm so glad. That if people are agnostic in faith, and we reach those kinds of people, and if you're here today, I'm so glad. Is that we can be agnostic, we can have our doubts, we can maybe push back on some of the things that church has done, but here's one thing I believe we can, none of us can intellectually argue with, is a person's story. No matter where you may be with faith, it is just really hard to get in someone's faith and say, no, that wasn't God. You know what's powerful? This was my life before Jesus, and this is my life after Jesus. This is where my marriage was before I actually truly followed Christ. And this is where it is now that I'm fully hunkered down and following Christ. Wow. I hear story after story after story of people coming into this place and sitting in this place and being exposed to the gospel of Jesus Christ and authentic Jesus followers. And it goes something like this. You know what? About 6 months ago, our marriage was in the toilet. Our kids fought all the time. Our family was imploding. And we gave God one more shot. And so we came to church and we sat down and we listened and we made some decisions. And God began to do something in our story. And God began to do something in our marriage. And God began to do something in our parenting. And God began to do some things that were really uncomfortable in our lives. But here's all I can say. We're not perfect, but this is who we were then before Jesus. And this is who we are now with Jesus. And we're not perfect and we don't have it all figured out. But it's like night and day. It's like light and darkness. I hear that story over and over and over and over again. Why? Because that is the redemptive plan of Jesus Christ. That is the redemptive plan of Jesus Christ. I was suicidal, but now I have hope. I was depressed, but now I have peace. I was an addict, but now I'm free. I had everything that the world told me. I had title, I had money, I had home, I had success, but I was empty on the inside. And since I found Jesus, since I exposed myself and took myself from the darkness into the light, I began to realize that I can only be content in him. See, something happens redemptive in our lives when we realize that we are more than a statistic, that we're a story, that I'm more than a number, that I'm a name, and that's only fulfilled in the person of Jesus Christ. So here's my question today as we close. What do you want your story to be? Over the next few weeks, you're going to hear some powerful stories. I'm going to creatively teach. We're going to do some creative video. We're going to do some interviews. You're going to hear stories of addiction and how God showed up. You're going to hear some stories of abuse and how God showed up. You're going to hear some stories of some extreme tragedy and how God showed up and how God works for the good of those who are in Christ Jesus. And I believe that God is still not done working, and the best days of your story are still in front of you. Amen? But it all revolves around what you do with the person of Jesus Christ. You can't get there on your own, and this is not judgment. This is just wisdom, experience, the gospel of Jesus Christ. You can't get there with more money. You can't get there with more counseling. You can't get there with more success. You can't get there on your own, more religion, more morality. At the gateway, Jesus says, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life, and no one enters into the Father except through me. So what do you want your story to be? Purpose? I hope so. Significance? Oh man, I hope so. Then the pathway is redemption. So here's the second question. What are you going to do with Jesus? Because the pathway of redemption, the pathway to your story is through Jesus. Today I mentioned this. In a few moments, we're going to have a couple of our volunteers in the back at our prayer tables. And through this next season, we're dealing with some pretty lofty things. And we're going to have these prayer tables open every weekend. We're going to have two of our specialized volunteers back there to pray with you. Anytime as we prepare to leave today, if you've got things that you want to pray for, if you want to take a step in a relationship with Jesus, if you know someone that is far from God and you want to pray for them to get closer to Jesus, I believe both Warren and Brenda will be back in the back today to pray for you. They'll respect you. They'll listen to you. They will not violate confidence with you, but they will just pray with you. So anytime as we close today, if you just want to pray with someone that's got skin on, please make sure that you pray today. But here's my question. Are you willing today, if you're sitting here, to take the step to know Jesus? And I recognize that this place is filled with Jesus followers, but I got to ask the question. Your story is only redeemed through Jesus. Your story only has hope through Jesus. How? I admit that I need Him. I admit that I'm broken. I admit that I'm sinful. I admit that the PG-13 and the rated R versions of my life, there's pages that are marred. And in order for you and I to have a right relationship with God through Christ, it begins with saying, there's parts of my story that are messed up, Jesus, and I call it sin. I'm going to call it for what it is. Number two is I believe that Jesus Christ came and gave His life for me, that He wasn't just a religious dude that walked the earth and talked some good smack, but that He came and He loved people unconditionally, that He gave His life for me unconditionally, that He came back from the dead for me, so I could have life in this life now. Number three, I choose. The pastor can't choose for you. Your parents, students can't choose for you. Your spouse can't choose for you. Faith, redemption is a personal choice of our own. So I'm going to ask this question today. If you don't know Jesus, would you be willing to take a step today? I'm not going to embarrass anybody, but we're going to pray. And if that's you and you feel a stirring in your heart, we do this every few weeks. I just want to make sure that I'm being responsible as a pastor. I'm being responsible as a Jesus follower. That if you're sitting here today and you don't know Jesus, I want to give you the opportunity. I just want to pray with you. So with heads bowed, would you do that for me? And eyes closed. God, I'm asking you to move in this place right now. God, I know you're here, and I know that as we begin to unpack these stories over the next few weeks, Lord, I pray that we will make it a priority not to miss any of them, because these stories are powerful. They are pages scattered with darkness and brokenness that have been redeemed. And today, Father, I feel that maybe there's some folks that are sitting here today, Lord, whose stories need to be redeemed, whose best days lie ahead of them, whose best chapters lie ahead of them. And so, Father, I pray right now, would you move by the power of your Holy Spirit? And with heads bowed and eyes closed, it's just a simple question. I'm not going to ask a lot. If you don't know Jesus today and you want to experience His redemption in your story, would you let me pray for you? It would be a privilege. I'm not going to call you out. I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm not going to drag you down here. But I'd love to pray for you. If that's you today, you want to begin a relationship with God, if you want to see your story redeemed, just put your hand in the air and I'll pray. I'm not going to spend a lot of time, but I just want to at least give an opportunity as we start this series today. Is there anyone here today? Just pause for just a few moments. Today, Father, I'm praying that you continue to move in us. Continue to understand, help us understand, Lord, that you are redeeming us, that you're changing us, that we're not done yet, that you still have so much ahead of us. And Lord, even though that we're marred and broken, Lord, the beauty of this is that we can be redeemed in Jesus. We can be redeemed in you. And I'm so grateful for a church that celebrates that. We pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen. Would you stand with me as we close? We've got just a few minutes. I've asked the team to sing this song again today because really it just talks about us wanting more of Christ, wanting more of Him. God, I don't need blessings. I don't need stuff from you. I need more of you. And when we have more of Christ in our lives, more of change and redemption takes place in our lives. The more that we allow that light switch to be flipped on, the more the darkness leaves in our lives. Again, and maybe if you want to pray with someone today or you want to know more about Jesus, make sure you go to one of the tables, talk with Warren and Brenda. If it's just a little bit of fear, make sure you flip over the card and check one of the boxes that you want to ask. You want to talk more about what it means to be a follower of Jesus. But don't leave this place today without letting us know. Be bold, letting us know that you want to follow Jesus. But let's just wrap up this time, guys. Will you just lead us and wrap up the day and just point us to Jesus in this moment?